SpaceX Starship serial number 15 is still not flying. What are the reasons and when can we expect a flight? Is SpaceX already working on the first orbital Starship and where is the first operational booster? Let's find out.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. And as always, there's been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. SpaceX is applying checkmark after checkmark towards a Starship number 15 flight test. Let's get the latest info together right before the big day. Cosmic Perspective was on site again for Y and pretty much captured the mood perfectly. It's this static atmosphere. Waiting for a Starship test flight is no easy task. Even if it might sound strange to an outsider, a Starship fan is going through a tough time when flight dates are shifted over and over again. One starts to search for info. Reasons need to be found. The delay needs to be justified. This isn't easy though. Most of the time, it's actually quite hard to identify the right reasons. This is LabPadre Media, epic footage of an equally epic undertaking. SpaceX's Starship number 15 performing its first static fire on April 26th. A perfect static fire. Raptor engine 54, 61 and 66 ignite, give out a mighty roar and no honk at all. A closer inspection immediately after the static fire reveals no damage or localized fire. All the problems from the early days seem to be long gone with the upgraded Starship number 15. Last but not least, we are being presented with some incredible RCS thruster testing. The sound tells a story of how powerful these thrusters actually are. Even if they are not the final hot gas thruster solution to be implemented later down the road, they would blow you right out of the picture with a single puff. On we go with the Starship number 15 static fire ignition test number 2 on April 27th. Same picture with a bit more fog. Perfect ignition, no characteristic honk caused by the valve systems after the finished burn. Those seem to be gone with Starship number 15. Well done, Team SpaceX, and huge thanks to Lewis and the LabPadre team for providing the footage to the world. Being asked by Tim Dodd if there was anything strange about the second static fire, Musk responded saying that they tested the header tanks and that all is good so far. So, what's the holdup? When hop? I mean, wasn't it supposed to be this week? Why are we not seeing a flight? In fact, on April 27th, Elon even tweeted that they are preparing for a flight this week. It's Friday. What happened? The FAA caused a small delay. Michael Sheets reported yesterday, though, that even the next three flights are authorized now. The FAA is making things less complicated for SpaceX, and that's a step in the right direction. The FAA also notes that the serial number 11 mishap investigation is still open, but that public safety issues are resolved. Furthermore, an FAA inspector is required to be on site for all Starship launches, similar to what was the case for Starship number 11. The flight termination system has been installed this morning, though, and a public notice warning of spaceflight activity has been issued as well. The weather will be the worst problem for a flight today. Next week, though, if there is no flight today, everything looks perfect after Monday. Fingers crossed, if there is a possibility for a flight, I will definitely be streaming and watching it together with you. Luckily, even if there is no test flight, there always is something else to take a look at in Boca Chica and at the SpaceX Starbase. This, for example, is Cosmic Perspective's view of the launch support tower being built right now, and let me tell you, it made lots of progress. This is it, the monster to be built in Boca Chica, Texas. The Starship and Super Heavy Launch Support Tower. It will stack Starships on top of Super Heavy boosters, stabilize the stack, provide access for crew and payload integration, it will provide lightning protection, and it will catch Super Heavy boosters and maybe even Starships. Looking at the construction through Blender 3D Creation Eccentric's virtual glasses reveals a different perspective you can't get anywhere else. It reveals the sturdiness of the construction. Massive crossbeams with even more massive intersections channel any weight from the tower down towards the giant concrete base. The tower is designed to carry a lot of weight. For quick assembly, the whole construction is segmented and will likely continue all the way up to the intended height with exactly these elements. There's not much time to waste in SpaceX's schedule, and so the construction won't take very long. Nick Henning has made an eye-opening size comparison of all the buildings at the SpaceX Starbase. From the large onion tents at the construction site used as the main sites for Starship segment assembly, through Starhopper, Low Bay, a GSE tank, the Mid Bay, a standard-sized Starship, a massive large super-heavy booster, an even larger monster-sized high bay, to a full Starship stack towering into the Boca Chica sky. Finally, we have the integration tower, and it will be even larger than the Starship stack sitting on top of the orbital launch mount. At 143 meters or 469 feet, it will be about the size of an average skyscraper. As a small update to the orbital launch mount, SpaceX workers have recently added caps to the top of the six legs of the construction. Mary from NASA Spaceflight has taken these pictures of cap pieces that seem to perfectly fit on top of the existing orbital launch mount. So we're likely going to see workers add them on top of the six pillars, and after that we might already see the launch table being stacked on top, which has recently received vertical cutouts on the inner ring. And there already is first speculation that these cutouts could be connected to a sound suppression system. A water deluge system could be channeled through these slits and be directed into the inner chamber where the Raptor engines of the Super Heavy booster would focus their exhaust after ignition. What do you think? Could this be a working solution? As always, tell me in the comments. Next up, we'll talk a bit more about the nose cone stress tester and its quirky construction. Let's find out more. What do you think about today's episode so far? Liked it? Give it a thumbs up. Didn't like it? Tell us in the comments what we can do better. Subscribe to the channel or even become a member by hitting the join button under the video and get awesome perks like access to our Discord and a chance to talk to me and the team or completely ad-free episode releases for supporters. Or get some fresh Y-wear in our merch store. Designs from the community including Neo Pork, Nick Henning, Brendan and me. Ready to make you look awesome for the next launch. Thank you for all your support. You rock. So the next very interesting object at the launch site right now would be the nose cone stress tester assembly. It's been puzzling the community for quite some time now. Since construction on it started, the community has been wondering what it is about and what SpaceX's plan behind it is. Now we seem to have a fairly good idea. It has pistons to be able to bend the forward flaps. It has an internal hydraulic ram to be able to squeeze the entire nose structure. A special nose cone is attached to transfer the pressure into the Starship hull. Encapsulated inside a girder structure, there is no escape for the poor nose cone. All in all, it's a pretty sophisticated setup to be able to test the structural integrity of a Starship nose cone during launch and during Max-Q. A few days ago, SpaceX transported it to the launch site and prepared the assembly for a first test, which has already been done. There was no visual change on the outside, so it seems like the serial number 12 nose cone was able to withstand the forces for now. Right between the landing pad and the new orbital fuel farm, SpaceX is still working on the largest blast berm ever erected in Boca Chica, Texas. It will shield the new tank farm from any mishaps that could occur at the landing pad. SpaceX no doubt is getting ready for a lot more failed landings. As stated many times before, launching a Starship into orbit is actually easier than catching a super heavy booster or landing a Starship back on the ground. Looking at Cosmic Perspectives footage for why the height becomes apparent. At this point, we're talking about roughly 10 meters or 30 feet. This will protect everything to the left from any sort of explosion occurring on the right. So SpaceX has failure in mind. It's part of the business, and through failure, SpaceX learns what to do on the next iteration. Jumping to the launch site, SpaceX is already preparing for what comes after Starship number 15 as well. Here you can see the stacking of the serial number 16 nose cone through Mary's lens. Improvements? Unknown, but there likely are new changes and things done differently here already compared to Starship 15. The question is how many prototypes SpaceX will need to get to the ready for orbit milestone from here on. Will one or two be enough, or will it take another five or maybe even more prototypes? And yesterday, SpaceX workers also moved the serial number 16 tank section from the mid bay over to the high bay. This can only mean one thing. SpaceX is getting ready to stack it. Soon, the nose cone is going to be mated with the tank section, and so as every time after a Starship launch, the next one is ready right away to continue the testing frenzy. And here's another big progress indicator. First only spotted inside of one of the construction tents, SpaceX has recently moved it out into the open. Let me introduce you to Starship serial number 17's fully protected belly. Representing the biggest single piece of Starship heat shield yet, it shows SpaceX's determination to make that orbital flight happen. Yes! The days of Starships without heat protection are counted. SpaceX seems to make good progress on manufacturing the heat tiles. There still are color differences. It's unknown if those are caused by manufacturing imperfection or if they are just normal variations. It will be interesting to see if the heat shield becomes more uniform over time. On we go with the tool needed to push Starships into orbit. After the recent booster number 1 disassembly, we're waiting for SpaceX to finish the next booster. What you're looking at here is one of the most beautiful pieces of hardware yet at the Starbase construction site. It's the super heavy BN3 aft dome supporting 28 Raptor engines. And it's recently been sleeved. This is another major step in the construction and paves the way for more booster stacking. And the Starship supposed to sit on top of that first orbital booster is taking shape as well. This is the aft dome of Starship number 20, the first one to go to orbit. Since this is the aft dome, it will receive the thrust pack assembly and the engine mounts. And since it's supposed to go to orbit, it will also receive vacuum Raptor engines. Here, for example, you can see what is likely a Pathfinder hardware for an orbital Starship aft dome. The roundly shaped adapter sitting on the side of the dome wall is likely a mounting point for a vacuum Raptor engine. 2 months left until SpaceX's internal goal for the first orbital Starship flight is here. Will SpaceX be able to make the target happen? What do you think? What are the chances of success? Tell me in the comments. Today's episode was made possible due to the collaboration of many different people from the space community. Special thanks go out to Cosmic Perspective, LabPadre, Blender 3D Creation Eccentric, Nick Henning and NASA Spaceflight. Links to their channels, Twitter and Patreon can be found in the description. Support them if you can. Today's episode is brought to you by the Ridge Wallet. It's light, sleek and industrial, it doesn't fold or awkwardly bulge in your back pocket, and it seriously changed my whole pocket situation. There's over 30 colors and styles, including carbon fiber and burnt titanium. It has 30,000 five-star reviews. It's so durable, it comes with a lifetime warranty. You can buy it and carry it around for the rest of your life, and the Ridge team is so confident that you'll like it that they'll let you test drive it for 45 days. You can send it back for a full refund if you don't love it. Back then I tested it and loved it from the first moment on. All my thoughts of missing my old wallet were gone after 10 minutes of using it. And guess what? I still use it and I still love it, and after half a year of constantly carrying it around, it still looks brand new. That speaks for itself. To make the most awesome wallet switch of your life and at the same time support What About It, go to rich.com/felix, that's rich.com/felix, and use the code Felix to get 10% off today with free worldwide shipping and returns. Change your pocket situation with Rich. Links in the description. Today's supporter shoutout goes to Chris Trottier, Lena Michoud, Cedric, Seth Green, Andrea May, Mike Deli, Jason Hendrich, Ryan Chilinski, Ron Wyckoff, and many others. You rock so much. Without you and all the other supporters, What About It would not be possible. Thank you for your support. Enjoy today's ad-free release. And do remember to join us on the Y Discord server. I am looking forward to thanking you in person. Today's team shoutout goes to Heisi again, coding in the background and now getting into the hot phase of our website revamp. I know so little of what you all are doing on the website team, and Heisi was the person to kick it all off in the first place. He approached me offering me to work on a new website for the Y family. If you'd only known what kind of monster you'd created, right? Thank you so much for all your help. You rock. Implemented later down the road, they would blow you and they would blow you. Let's find out. What did I write there? Size of an average skyscape. Skyscape. Yeah. It's a skyscaper. It's been positioned right between glass berm ever erected in Boca Chica, Texas.
So, yes,
it did. They're erecting something large.
Starship is not being approved by the FAA.